Hello everybody and welcome to another War Thunder video. I should probably check to make sure. Let's put this on just in case this video lasts a little longer than normal. We have an Answers from Developers that just released moments ago. I was busy in War Thunder looking at some of the tech trees to see what I'm going to be doing at some point today. And I saw this pop up. I haven't poked into it really, so I'm extremely excited. I just got a message about it as well on Steam. So just in time for Answers from Developers. Let's see what we've got for this time. Usual disclaimer applies here. This is going into the upcoming content section of the channel because sometimes they talk about content they may or may not be adding in the future, as well as changes that will possibly come in the future. And these videos are usually a little bit lengthier because I'll read the question, give my opinion on that, then I'll read the answer and give my opinion on that. So here we go. Answers from Developers. Let us see. Dear players, another round of questions and answers with War Thunder producer. Okay, wow, it actually looks pretty lengthy, so that gives me boner right there, so we're already starting off great. Something's in my ear. Let's move straight on to the first question. Do you plan to add a variety of goals to PvE tank battles? For example, instead of capturing points, destroying pillboxes, bunkers, etc., or repairing them as an option? They're talking about PvE tank battles. Are they talking about, like, custom battles where you play with AI? Or are we talking... Because I don't think we're talking about the assault game mode. And if we are, I have still never played any of the assault game mode. So I'm a little behind on that. Little unsure of what exactly they're talking about, but I'm going to take it as they're talking about PvE in custom battles, which I have played. From time to time when I get bored, I don't want to play the main game, I'll just play against some AI, some bots. And I do like the idea of, instead of capturing points, having different objectives like pillboxes and bunkers. Now, I kind of wish they would actually release single missions for ground forces, or at least fix the goddamn single missions achievement on Steam, because I cannot obtain it. It is impossible to, for me, because I've already completed most of the single missions, and it doesn't track ones you had already completed, and you can't replay them, and they don't track. So, or you can replay them, but even if you do replay them, they don't track on the achievement, so it's impossible for me to get it. So I am up to waiting for new ones unless they fix it. And they said a little while back, I remember them saying something about tank single missions, and I would love to see those. Now, that would be a lot better. Like, with air battles, there's always some sort of difference between single missions. They're always kind of fun. They're always, you know, there's always differences between them. Go here, escort, fight these guys, or, you know, recon this, attack this ground, you know, so on and so on and so on. Defend ground vehicles from air or ground attacks. It's always really, really fun and always unique. And I would love to see ground versions of that. How amazing would that be, right? So let's see what they say. The answer is, we believe that goals and tasks like these are more suited for asymmetric battle types. For example, this is possible in World War missions. There's your answer. I don't really have an opinion on that too much. We're going to move straight on to the next question, which is, will those that have bought the P-40 get access to testing Italian ground vehicles when they're released? This is a very good question. I've actually been asked this a few times on my comment section. Because there are two Italian ground vehicle packs available right now, the P-40 and the M-26. And there is no indication that buying them will gain you access to the testing for Italian ground forces. But with every other tech tree they've ever done, that's always how it's been, right? You know, they release it, there's some premiums, it's like, oh, buy the premiums and then you gain access to the tech tree. Usually. So it would make sense that they would do that here, but there was no indication because there was only two whole vehicles released and we don't have the tech tree yet, so, you know, we just didn't know. I imagined it would have been. I wouldn't have seen any reason as to why it wouldn't have been. I do own the P-40. I don't own the M-26. And a lot of other people own the P-40. And a lot of other people own the P-20 or the M-26. Did I say P-26? I might have said that. The M-26. And they're curious to know, are you going to be able to just gain instant access to the Italian tech tree when they're released without having to shell out more money to buy some other pack they might introduce? I'm hoping that it's a yes, because that would make sense to me. And the answer is yes. So there you go. If you own either of the packs or both of them, you're going to gain access to the Italian Ground Forces tech tree when it's released so that you can start grinding away and testing it before it is fully publicly released. The next question is, why do some vehicles' ATGMs explode when they're hit? For example, the AMX 13 SS11, while the others, they don't. For example, the IT1 and the RAK JPZ2. Now, are they talking about when they're midair and armed, or when they are the ones that are sitting on the vehicles? You know, the actual missile sitting on the tank itself before it's fired. I don't actually know what they're talking about. I remember a long time ago, there was somebody that I was in a squad with that was trying to test this, but it wasn't with ATGMs. In fact, I think this was long before ATGMs were added. It was when there was rocket artillery only. And I remember trying to drive one of them, and we were in realistic battles, custom battle, and he couldn't set off my rockets. So we went into simulator, and there he could set off my rockets, but not in realistic or arcade. It would only damage them, at the time at least. So I don't know if, like, that's what we're talking about. Now, if they're talking about mid-air missiles, I've never been able to kill a mid-air ATGM. So I don't know if that's the case. I think they're talking about the actual canisters that are on, or the actual weapons that are on the vehicle itself. I've never actually seen it happen, nor have I ever done it before, so I can't really give an opinion based off of experience. And the answer is, the missile explosion is currently fatal for those vehicles whose armor cannot protect against the HE fragmentation action of detonated missiles. Okay, so basically what they're saying is, the AMX 13 is lightly armored, therefore it explodes, the vehicle's destroyed because it can't withstand the explosion of the missile, while something like the IT-1 does. That doesn't make much sense to me, though, because the RAK doesn't have armor either. Does it? I've never seen one of these things ever ricochet a shot or not die from a machine gun, a high caliber machine gun. I've never seen it. So I don't know if I really accept that answer too much, but maybe somebody can put it in greater detail for me. Moving on to the next question, we have, in tank AB, or arcade battles, when there is one crew member left, he gets in the driver's seat expecting a replenishment and continues to do nothing. Can you include a settings option to make this tanker sit in the gunner seat? Oh! Okay, this is actually both good and bad. I've noticed this. Now, okay, I made this huge complaint a long time ago, and I still have it partly. So, okay, hold on, give me a second here. I'm trying to fully think about my argument I'm going to make here. First of all, let's talk about what they're talking about. So essentially what happens in arcade battles, when you have your crew replenishment unlocked, and you say you take a big old hit in the rear or in the side or something, it knocks out all but one crew, and it just so happens to be the driver. And I've usually sometimes noticed that if you lose a crew somewhere else in the tank, they don't move anywhere. Like, if you have one crew left, they never move, at least from what I've noticed. I guess sometimes they may, but at least in my experience, I've never noticed them to move. So if the machine gunner's left... Oh, no, yes, they do, actually, come to think of it. So if you're down to one crew, I have noticed, like, my machine gunner moves to the driver's seat, or my commander moves to the driver's seat, as opposed to the gunner seat. This is pointless, as this person says, because when you're in crew replenishment mode, you cannot cancel it and you cannot move. So it's pointless to go into the driver's seat. It would make more sense to go into the gunner seat, right? Therefore, you have a chance to defend yourself and fight back. Though sometimes I wouldn't like this, because sometimes you get hit in the rear, all that's showing is your turret, and your driver can't be hit, so they just keep shooting your turret, and if your gunner comes back, then they just shoot the turret, and, so... I do agree with them. I would actually prefer the gunner to be the primary setting rather than the driver, because the driver can't do anything. It'd be different if you could drive away, but no, you still have to wait, so why not wait and have the chance to defend yourself, right? Now, one of the biggest things I have an issue with isn't when you lose all your crew except one guy and you're on crew replenishment. My biggest issue is when you've lost most of your crew. Say you lose your driver, all right? And your commander, say your commander's, because usually it seems like the commander or machine gunner goes first. So say you've lost your commander, and all you have in your tank left is a driver, a gunner, and a loader. One thing that I cannot fucking stand so much is when you lose one of your crew, and the loader is reloading the gun, and then he decides right at the end to stop loading to get into a different seat, and thus you have to restart the loading at an even longer time. That doesn't make any sense, and it's extremely annoying, and it gets you killed a lot. So that, I think, is probably the biggest issue I personally have with the different swapping of the different crew. I think they should finish loading before switching to a different seat or something like that. And there are various other minor things I have an issue with. But overall, I like what this person's asking, and I would prefer to have the option to choose gunner seat being a higher priority. So I'm curious to see what the answer is. And it is, we'll consider this option, thanks. Okay, good. It's good that they're considering that, because I like this idea. Okay, and I think it'd be great. And having the option to choose where you want it. So if you don't want it, you can keep him in the driver's seat. That is also good, to allow players to choose what they would prefer to use. All right, the next question is, could you make it so that on capture points, tank anti-air gun ammunition is restocked? Okay, so I'm assuming we're talking about, like, the MBT with you know, the 20mm autocannons and stuff on top of the vehicles that are meant for aircraft. I'm assuming that's what we're talking about. Because I know for a fact I'm driving AA vehicles and I can replenish my ammunition and cartridges on, or magazines, on a cap point because I've done it before recently. So that's probably why they said tank anti-air rather than AA or something like that. I don't really have an opinion on this too much because I haven't really driven that many vehicles with these types of weapons on top, nor have I run out of ammo in them. So the answer is this may be possible. So if you've been wondering that, there's your answer. The next question is, here we go, holy nuts. After one update, the German branch had a whole three Focke-Wulf 190A5s, which differ in pretty small ways, making them less unique. Is there a... Okay, I beg to differ. I will rip each ball sack... Or each ball sack? I will rip each hair out of your testicles if you... No, but your testicles don't grow hairs, do they? It's the sack, the scrotum, that grows the hairs, not the testicles. The testicles sit inside, float around. Well, they don't really float around. They're, you know, suspended. Anyways, my point is... We need more variants, mini variants of vehicles. Where's our P-40, P-47, and BF-110 variants? Okay, but okay, I understand what they're saying. Let's continue and see what they've got to say. Is there a possibility, through remodeling them, for example, to assemble the 3190A5 modifications into one, providing the ability to remove machine guns, attach modules, and replace two other aircraft with the A3679 models, for example? Suddenly, I would want to gut this person. I don't want to remove their hair testicles or testicle hairs. I would rather just completely gut them and let them hang up on a pole where they're slowly going to bleed out as their guts are hanging out there, and for crows to just peck while they're still alive. And we'll inject them with something so that they can feel every single moment of it, because fucking removing vehicles is the absolute worst fucking thing I can think of. I'm sick and tired of it. I don't want more of that bullshit. I'm talking removing and replacing, not removing and making them hidden like the Kingfishers and stuff. That's different, because you get to keep those. I'm talking about entire replacements. I hate it. I've hated it since they started it. I don't want them to keep doing it. Which is also why I'm very touchy on the BMP-1P and the T-64BV subject. We have no such plans. If new versions of the A5 are added, they might be combined into one package. Well, hopefully they keep having no such plans. People have forgotten that, you know, having a lineup of vehicles is actually good, as opposed to just having one. The next question is also about German aircraft, so this could be interesting. The BF-109K could historically be fitted with a bomb mounting for a 500 kilogram bomb. That could also carry two MK-108s inside the wings. Not under the wings. And the MG-131 was replaced with the MG-151/15. Are such variants of the aircraft or modifications for the K-4 possible? That's interesting. 108s inside the wings? So we're not talking cannon pods, are we? We're talking full-on wing mount. Or like, not even wing mounts. They're just wing upgrades. I did not know that. So that's interesting. I'm very curious to see what they're going to say about this. Here's an example. Wow, that is really weird. I'm not used to seeing that sort of thing on a BF-109 higher than an E. I'm used to seeing cannon pods as opposed to actual inside the wing weapons. That's really interesting. Or is this an upside down wing? Because that looks like a landing gear. Perhaps this is a cannon pod and I'm just sounding like an idiot. Shit. For a second, I thought maybe that wasn't an upside down wing. We're constantly adding new suspended weaponry and various modifications for offensive armament. The BF-109 is no exception. The existence of the modifications you described on these aircraft requires checking and verification, since in some cases we've encountered this before. Suggestions about introducing BF-109 modifications were based on unverified and non-authentic sources. So in other words, they'll consider it, but they have to look into it, which is good. Do you plan to add the POTISMA aircraft? What the fuck is that? All right, hold on. No spoilers. I gotta freaking look up what this goddamn aircraft is now because I've never fucking heard of it. I've probably seen it before. Let's see. All right, according to Google Chrome images, it's very like it looks like a PE mixed with something else, essentially. I think this may or may not be the thumbnail of the video, because usually if there's any talk about a vehicle, I'll put that. From what I can tell, it looks kind of neat. It looks like it's got some heavy firepower there in the nose. And I imagine it can carry some sort of payload. Well, let's see what the answer is. Not in the near future, but the USSR had many interesting aircraft that we may well add at some point. One of those unusual aircraft is the new Tandem Mai. What? And by the way, it's actually my Tandem and not Tandem Mai. It's just another inaccuracy that War Thunder gives. Anyways, pet peeves aside, not in the near future. So was this made before the Tandem was released? Because they say it in a way that it's like, oh yeah, it's kind of like the new one, as in this is one of the interesting ones. Either that, or they're just referring to it as an interesting aircraft, and more that they're going to add in the future are going to be similarly interesting. I don't care, as long as there's something new coming at some point. There's always something to look forward to, in my opinion. The next question is, which technical characteristics are balance values for aircraft, tanks, and vessels? For tanks, everyone knows it's reloading. Are there other balance parameters for vehicles? Is that how people balance tanks? By the reload rate? I mean, yeah, sure, reload rate can sometimes make the tank, but I often look at armor and maneuverability as well. Because a vehicle can have a really bad reload time, but it can have amazing maneuverability. So, I don't know. I've never heard of balancing based off of reloading. So I think everyone is a little bit subjective. The answer is these are mostly economic parameters and determine the cost of repairs and ammunition, along with the presence of absence of specific types of ammunition in the ammo racks and their allowed amount. Right. I don't know. I don't have an opinion on this. The next question is a question about modules. From time to time, new modules are added to or removed from some vehicles. That is true. These then have to be researched or bought again. In addition, the vehicle loses its peak. Do you plan to add some sort of recalculation of RP for modules? The question is relevant, for example, for the M24 with a space, spaded, quote unquote, tanks, which have been reset 5 times already. They have? What? What do they mean by reset? Because reset, in my mind, is completely redone. You have to grind out every modification again because they're all entirely new. As opposed to adding a new one or removing something. Adding a new one, oh, I got to go back and grind that new thing, and then it'll respade it or whatever. That, I guess, is probably what they're talking about because I don't think they would remove an entire modification list and reset the whole thing. And I'm assuming they're talking about the M24 Chaffee. Hopefully. And the answer to this is, quote unquote, spaded actually provides no benefit in gameplay terms, so we don't count it as a significant loss. Wait, what? Okay, now I'm getting really confused, especially considering that adding new modules tends to make the vehicle stronger. True. As for replacing a module, we try to either replace it automatically or provide another means to unlock it as quickly as possible. See, now I'm super confused. Spaded actually makes no benefit? Okay, for maybe perhaps they're being extremely literal. When you have the ace symbol, or the spade symbol, the ace of spades symbol, on a vehicle, that in and of itself doesn't make it more powerful. But at the same time, it means you've unlocked every modification, which in turn means you're more powerful than a standard version of that vehicle, right? Correct? Am I not wrong in saying that? You correct me if I'm wrong, but that's what that would mean. Although, this whole ordeal here has kind of confused me, because when I grind out modifications, which I haven't done all that much recently, but when I used to, and when I'm going to be soon, I grind out all the modifications. Like, for example, all my British tanks, have none of them are currently elite. They used to be, half of them used to be elite, but they went and added smoke and, you know, smoke shells and stuff. So, therefore, every single vehicle on that list, I have to go back through and grind out those new modifications. I personally don't have a problem with this, but does that mean they're reset? Hardly not. You know what I mean? It's not like they're losing anything. All of those modifications I had previously are still there, so the vehicle is still as powerful as it was when I ground out all the modifications. The new modifications are simply just smoke shells, which is just going to give me more opportunities in battle. That's it. It's not like it's losing some of its combat capability, and maybe that's what these people mean, or that's what this question means. It means they're asking, when the spade symbol disappears, does that mean the vehicle's weaker? Absolutely not. It's different if, say, they remove a whole bunch of modifications from the vehicle and not replace them. Then yes, your vehicle's going to get weaker based on the modifications. If they removed engine or something like that, you're going to lose those engine modifications you've made to the vehicle. But only ever adding, the answer is correct. Only ever adding modifications to it is going to make it more powerful, regardless of whether or not you find it annoying to grind out the new modifications. Your vehicle is just going to be more powerful or have more variety to use in battle. You know what I mean? So, I don't exactly see what the problem is here, personally. But then again, it doesn't have to be a complaint. They're just asking about it. That's my personal opinion on it. Maybe I completely missed the point and I'm confused on it, because I am a little bit confused on it. Somebody might have to re-explain that one to me. Do you plan to add the ability to utilize user-made content like live camouflages and sights on the PlayStation? So here's a PS question for those of you that play that. I'm particularly interested in tank sights. For some vehicles, they provide an advantage in simulator battles. Experience is good, but this quality of life change wouldn't hurt. I still have yet to use any custom-made tank sights. And I would love to. If anybody in the comment section that has made it this far into the video knows any good sources for good custom sites, please let me know. I would love to download some of them and use them in the game, because I've yet to use any and I would love to. But I don't exactly know where to look for them. I know where to look for them, I just don't know what I'm looking for, really, to be honest. The answer to this is, unfortunately, we have no plans for this. So, unfortunately, PlayStation players, they have no plans to allow you to utilize live content, which is unfortunate. Hopefully at some point in the future that has changed. Though all the you Xbox players are over there sitting, still commenting on my old video asking if the Xbox version is still planned. I don't know. I just covered the news. Don't shoot the messenger here. I don't control the Xbox version of the game. If it hasn't come out yet, that's not my fault. Okay, moving along. Next question is, in patch 1.77, you added various weather conditions. Hold on. Excuse me. You added various weather conditions, but it's always daytime in battle. Are you having a laugh, mate? Very rarely dawn or dusk. You must not play the game all that much. Where are the rains and the mists? Again, you must not play the game all that much. Like in the last version, night maps happen very rarely. Okay. I've seen maybe one or two nights since the update went up. So that is pretty rare, at least in my experience. The only way to check out the weather conditions is in a test drive. Now, this dawn or dusk thing is bullshit. I am constantly fucking in matches that are dawn and dusk, and it's extremely annoying. There are plenty of daytime battles. And as for Mist and Reigns, do you know how many fucking matches I've played in the past, like, 3 weeks that have had rain and Mist? Don't you dare sit there and say it's very rare. I'm talking a huge percentage. Okay, I'm kidding. Not a huge percentage. That's an exaggeration. But if you compare it to how many, like, if I compared, like, my past 3 years of playing this fucking game and maybe experiencing rain once and all of my ground battles and a snowstorm in simulator and a rainstorm in simulator, and then none ever again. In just the past few weeks, I've experienced tons of rain battles. Tons of them. And they're gorgeous. And the weather is dynamic. Remember when I covered the dev vlog and I said I hope this is actually dynamic? It fucking is dynamic, guys. If you haven't actually experienced this, then I am sorry. But there is... You'll join into a match, and it'll be raining. It'll be misty, it'll be dark, because it's overcast. And there'll be rain pouring down, you'll see it splashing off your tank, you'll see the puddles and everything, and it'll be hard to see. And then, 10 minutes into the match, the clouds are moving! The rain is stopping! And suddenly the sun is shining through, and it's like, it's literally like waking up in the morning, and just after it had rained. You can fucking smell the new wet grass outside. That is how awesome War Thunder is now with these weather conditions, where it actually does dynamically move. It'll start rainy and end not rainy, and it's fully dynamic. The only thing I've yet to see is it starting daytime and then turning into rain. That's the only thing I've actually not seen in battle yet. I love the new weather effects, but I think this person saying this, that it's rare, is incorrect. And I think me saying that it's not rare is incorrect. It's completely fucking chance. And it just so happens that I have experienced it tons while this person has experienced it almost none. It's just up to chance, I guess. But I guess I got lucky. Either they got really unlucky or I got really lucky. One or the other. I guess it's up to you guys to post in the comments your experiences and we can kind of base an average off of that. But I'm curious to see what the answer is. They're in the game with the probability of happening that we consider sufficient. Okay, well, I considered it sufficient because I'm experiencing them a lot. After 1.77, we increase the probability of various types of weather occurring in random battles. Okay, there you go. There's your answer. And again, you don't know how much this person that asked this question is playing. They may only play a couple hours a day, every other day, a week, you know. And when you say that, that's not fair to judge. And I'm talking about them. It's not fair to judge the probability of finding rain matches when you don't play that often, but you can't turn around and say, well, then you have to play, you know, 10 hours every other day just to see some. That also doesn't work. So again, it all comes down to probability. But in my experience, I've experienced plenty of dawn and dusk. I've experienced plenty of rain. The only thing I haven't really experienced all that much is night recently. I have experienced it, yes, but not as much. So yeah. I would love like a total rainstorm. Like you can turn on like torrential rain in custom battles. I wish we could get more of that, because that I haven't experienced all that much. And I've seen snow, but I haven't seen like a thick snowstorm since that old simulator battle match I played way back in the day. All right, next question is, will you add a function for enabling or disabling different types of weaponry, in particular offensive armament on aircraft, multi-turret tanks, or tanks with two guns and vessels? I'll use aircraft as an example. I'd like the ability to disable the high caliber and just use the machine guns and vice versa. Disable the machine guns and work with only one large caliber, but at the same time, the firing itself should be on the same old button. Okay, I was just about to say, well, you can fire only machine guns or only cannons, but you have to bind them to certain keys. For example, I have, for aircraft, my machine guns are bound to the one key, and my cannons or heavy caliber weapons are bound to the second key. This is good because you don't always want to just fire off all of your weapons, because sometimes the ballistics don't add up, sometimes you're out of range, and you know it's not optimal to use your heavy cannons. Sometimes it's good just to trick somebody. I've seen plenty of times, like during the World War II Chronicles, where I was flying my aircraft and there was an enemy aircraft in front of me trying to run away, and he's getting away from me. He's a lot faster than me. So what I'll do is I'll fire a burst of machine gun ammo, which I have plenty of. I'm not wasting cannon, but I'll fire a small burst of machine gun ammo at him. This will trick him into thinking I'm trying to go all out, and thus he'll make maneuvers, slowing him down, allowing me to catch up and blast his ass with my cannons. But what this person's asking is they want to use, like, the good old left-click button, you know? Like, maybe just have, maybe the hotkey be disable machine guns or disable cannons, and then whatever you're using. That would be good, because honestly, in my opinion, it is very awkward to try and use only machine guns for an extended period of time. I only use the 1 and 2 keys for burst fires. I'll burst, fly away, burst, or burst, wait, burst. I can't sit there and hold down the machine gun button and make accurate fire at the same time. It's much easier for me to aim with the mouse, in my personal opinion. Thus, I think allowing the ability to turn off cannons would actually be very useful. Or vice versa. That is actually something I like. I like the sound of this. And the answer is, not at the moment. So, well, not a priority, but I still like the idea. It's a good idea. No, we're done? Already? Aw, we just started. I thought this was going to be a big one. That sucks. Well, there were some good questions in here, guys. I did enjoy this one. Too bad there wasn't, like, really that much to do with the actual vehicle content, just a little bit, and that was about it. But anyways, that's probably going to bring this one to an end. Feel free to post your opinions in the comment section on any of the questions and answers here or anything that I talked about. Feel free to waffle on. But that's going to bring this one to an end, and I'll see you guys in the next War Thunder video.